do understand that when we sing anywhere with Jesus, I can go to sleep, that does not include this next hour. But, you know, if that happens, it won't be the first time. So, we have a question about the subject of worship. First Sunday night of the month, we try to devote to questions and answers. And this question comes in connection with worship. And here's the question. Somewhat abbreviated, it was a long question. Why do we call singing, praying, preaching, communion, and giving the five acts of worship? Now, that's mostly what we're going to be talking about. There's a follow-up. If giving money is worship, then is giving time to a church project like folding bulletins an act of worship? All right. Well, these are really good questions. And we'd like to begin with looking at the definitions of the key words that are translated worship in the Old and in the New Testament. In the Old Testament, shakah is usually translated worship, although 99 times, but bow, 31, bow down, 18, obeisance, 9, and reverence, 5. So, depending on the context, it is translated a little bit differently, but basically, all of these are very close to one another in meaning. Now, in the New Testament, the main word is proskuneo, which means literally to kiss the hand toward, to fall to the ground in profound reverence. And we'd like to look at two passages in which that is used. First one is Matthew 8:2, and these are a couple of verses you might want to add to your list of memory verses to try to keep handy in case you need this. Behold, a leper came and worshipped him, saying, Lord, if you are willing, you can make me clean. Now, this person came to Jesus and worshipped him. Matthew chapter 9, verse 18, while he spoke these things to them, behold, a ruler came and worshipped him, proskuneo, saying, my daughter has just died, but come and lay your hand on her, and she will live. The reason I call these two to attention is because they're close together, and they both make the point that Jesus accepted worship. As you know, Peter refused to be worshipped at the household of Cornelius. An angel refused worship when John fell down before him in the book of Revelation. But Jesus accepts worship. And the thing that is significant is that you should not allow Jehovah's Witnesses to tell you, oh, this is a different word for Jesus than for the Father. No, it's not. Look it up. It's the same word, proskuneo, the same word used of worshiping the Father is used of worshiping Jesus. And so if they tell you it's not the same word, they're either lying or they have been misinformed, mistaught. But you can simply go to a number of sources and say, well, look here, it's the same word. Who told you it wasn't the same word? Now let's look at just a couple of general scriptures. The first one we want to look at is Joshua chapter 5 and verse 14. I don't know if you can read that on the screen in the white there, but I can't. So I'm going to look it up. Joshua chapter 5 and verse 14. This has to do with the just prior to conquering the promised land. Joshua coming in contact with the commander of the Lord's army. So he said to him, but as commander of the army of the Lord, I have now come. And Joshua fell on his face to the earth and worshiped and said to him, what does my Lord say to his servant? And so he was bowing down before him. He was honoring him, reverencing him, worshiping him in that particular text. The next one we want to look at is Psalm 95 and verse 6. Psalm 95 and verse 6. O come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker. So these are just a couple of general passages that involve worship. And again, they involve bowing down, honoring, and so on. Now, there are many other verses of this type, but now we want to notice some verses that are associated with various expressions of worship. Sometimes people, as in the question that was asked, call them acts of worship, which I suppose is okay. I think I prefer to think of them as expressions of worship because they are different ways of expressing worship to God. So let's begin with the subject of giving. And to do that, we want to go back to Genesis chapter 22 and verse 5. Genesis chapter 22 and verse 5. And we want to notice a couple of things about this verse. Now, you'll recall that this is Abraham's response to the command that he was given by God to take and offer his only son Isaac, his only begotten son, as an offering. In Genesis 22 and verse 5, we read, "And Abraham said to his young men, 'Stay here with the donkey. The lad and I will go yonder and worship, and we will come back to you.'" Now, that's a very significant verse. First of all, it does show that worship can be in a certain place. You'll remember that Jesus had a conversation with the woman at the well, and she asked the question, is it on this mountain or in Jerusalem? And Jesus said, the place is no longer going to be significant. But in Old Testament times, it was. God had appointed this place. Later on, we'll see that Shiloh was the place that people went to worship. And later still, it was the city of Jerusalem. But worship can be associated with a place. Now, do we have to be in a certain place to pray or something like that? No, not particularly. But in this case, they needed to be in a particular place. So the worship that God had asked of Abraham was tied to a place. They were going to go yonder and worship. They were going to worship in that place. Notice the expression of optimism. He had been commanded to offer up his only son, but he says, we will come back. Abraham knew that even if he offered Isaac, that God would restore his life from the dead, a fact which is mentioned in Hebrews chapter 11. So several significant things are listed in that verse. Now, what was the worship? The worship was offering Isaac. As it turned out, God spared Isaac, and something else was offered that we read about in verse 13. We'll get to that in just a second. So we know as his worship, he intended to offer up Isaac to God, as he had been commanded to do. After Isaac was spared, he offered up something else as worship. And that we find in verse 13. Then Abraham lifted up his eyes and looked, and there behind him was a ram caught in a thicket by its horns. So Abraham went and took the ram and offered it for a burnt offering instead of his son. So he was going yonder to worship, in which he would have been offering up his son, but he worshiped instead by offering up a ram, since God spared Isaac's life. So the act of giving was worship, is defined as worship in this text. If we didn't have any other passage in the Bible, this would prove that giving is offering, can be worship. It is offering up something to God. So he went to an appointed place and offered worship in the form of giving a sacrifice and then returned. But we want to look at a few other passages that deal with this subject too. So let's go to Deuteronomy chapter 26 and verse 10. Deuteronomy chapter 26 and verse 10. In this verse, "And now behold, I have brought the first fruits of the land which you, O Lord, have given me. Then you shall set it before the Lord your God and worship the Lord your God." So the offering up of the first fruits, that act of giving, is considered worship. Let's go on to the next example, which involves Elkanah, in 1 Samuel chapter 1 and verse 3. 1 Samuel chapter 1, verse 3. "This man went up from the city yearly to worship and sacrifice to the Lord of hosts in Shiloh." And also the two sons of Eli, were Hophni and Phinehas, were priests of the Lord. They were there. Okay, so he went up again, like Abraham, to a certain place where worship was to be offered. And that worship involved a sacrifice, an offering. Now, let's look at verse 19, same chapter. "Then they arose early in the morning and worshiped before the Lord and returned and came to their house at Ramah." So, what were they planning to do? To go to Shiloh and worship, to give an offering to God. A sacrifice to the Lord of hosts. So, summarizing that, they did. They went there, they worshiped, and they came back. So, the offering of the sacrifice was worship. Well, let's go to another example. In 2 Kings chapter 36, we see a number of passages where giving is mentioned in connection with worship. 2 Kings chapter 17 and verse 36. "But the Lord who brought you out from the land of Egypt with a great power and an outstretched hand or arm, him you shall fear, him you shall worship, and to him you shall offer sacrifice." And so we see worship and sacrifice associated in that passage. Next, let's run up to 1 Chronicles chapter 29 and look at verses 20 and 21. 1 Chronicles chapter 29, verses 20 and 21. "Then David said to the congregation, 'Now bless the Lord your God.' So all the congregation blessed the Lord God of their fathers, and bowed their heads and prostrated themselves before the Lord and the king. And they made sacrifices to the Lord and offered burnt offerings to the Lord on the next day, 1,000 bulls, 1,000 rams, 1,000 lambs, with their drink offerings and sacrifices in abundance for all Israel." So, once again, worshiping is associated with the giving and these offerings. Let's go to 2 Chronicles chapter 7, looking at the first four verses. 2 Chronicles chapter 7. "Now, when Solomon had finished praying, fire came down from heaven and consumed the burnt offering and the sacrifices, and the glory of the Lord filled the temple. And the priests could not enter the house of the Lord because of the glory of the Lord had filled the Lord's house. When all the children of Israel saw how the fire came down and the glory of the Lord on the temple, they bowed their faces to the ground on the pavement and worshiped and praised the Lord, saying, "For he is good, for his mercy endures forever." And then the king and all the people offered sacrifices before the Lord. It is obvious that this is a time of worship in the words that they said and in the sacrifices that they offered. And we're going to be coming back to Chronicles in just a moment, but you might remember a passage from Matthew chapter 2 and verse 11, when the wise men came to Jesus. Matthew chapter 2 and verse 11. And when they had come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary, his mother, and fell down and worshiped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented gifts to him, gold and frankincense and myrrh. So once again, the giving of a gift is associated with worship. But now let's come back to 1 Chronicles chapter 16 and verse 29. 1 Chronicles chapter 16 and verse 29. Give to the Lord the glory due his name. Bring an offering and come before him. O worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. So again, bringing the offering constitutes worship. Oh, worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Now, there is another element brought into what we're talking about here, and that is the element of holiness. Worship to God should involve a holy people who are thinking holy thoughts and expressing holy words, dressed in holy rather than unholy attire. Everything about it should speak holiness to the Lord. This is not the only passage that mentions that. Let's go to Psalm 29 and verse 2. Psalm 29 and verse 2. Give unto the Lord the glory due his name. Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. And another passage, Psalm 96 and verse 9. Psalm 96, okay. Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness, tremble before him all the earth. All right, and then finally, Psalm 99. And verse 9, the last verse of the psalm, exalt the Lord our God and worship in his holy hill, for the Lord our God is holy. So we've seen the connection of giving to worship, and we also have this added dimension of the concept of holiness as we are worshiping our God. Well, I think there's more passages on giving being worship than practically anything else in the New Testament. So let's move on to the next one that's already been hinted at, and that is praying. And for this, we want to take a look at Abraham's servant in Genesis chapter 24. You remember that Abraham wanted a wife selected for his son Isaac, and so he sent a servant to accomplish this task. And in Genesis chapter 24, verses 26 and 27, the servant is on his way. He meets Rebekah. And so we see his description here. Then the man bowed down his head and worshiped the Lord. And he said, "Blessed be the Lord God of my master Abraham, who has not forsaken his mercy and his truth toward my master. As for me, being on the way, the Lord led me to the house of my master's brethren." So he bowed his head, he was thankful, he worshiped God. Now let's notice verse 48. As he is recounting this story, he says, "And I bowed my head and worshiped the Lord, and blessed the Lord, God of my master, Abraham, who had led me in the way of truth to take the daughter of my master's brother for his son." So he says he worshiped when he prayed. He's classifying prayer as worship. Now let's go to the New Testament, Acts chapter 4. And verses 24 through 31. Acts chapter 4, verses 24 through 31. Would you call this worship? Beginning with verse 24. "So when they heard that, they raised their voice to God with one accord and said, 'Lord, you are God, and who made heaven and earth and the sea and all that is in them, who by the mouth of your servant David have said, why did the nations rage and the people plot vain things? And the kings of the earth took their stand, and the rulers were gathered together against the Lord and against his Christ. For truly against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed, both Herod and Pontius Pilate with the Gentiles and the people of Israel were gathered together to do whatever your hand and your purpose determined beforehand to be done. Now, Lord, look on their threats." They are addressing the Lord. Is this not prayer? "Now, Lord, look on their threats and grant to your servants that with all boldness they may speak your word, by stretching out your hand to heal, and that signs and wonders might be done through the name of your holy servant, Jesus." And when they had prayed, the place where they were assembled together was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, and they spoke the word of God with boldness. Would you not say that they were worshiping as they uttered this prayer? I think most people would agree with that. The word worship may not be used, but it is obvious that that's what it was, just as with Abraham's servant. Now we want to go to the next thing, which is singing. We've talked about praying and giving. What about singing? Another association is with singing that is regarded as worship. So let's go look at a few examples of this. And first of all, we'll go back to Psalm 66 and verse 4. Psalm 66 and verse 4. "All the earth shall worship you and sing praises to you. They shall sing praises to your name." And let's back up a little bit to 2 Chronicles chapter 29. 2 Chronicles chapter 29 and verse 25 is one of the memory verses that we recommend because it shows that in the Old Testament, God authorized the use of instrumental music. In the New Testament, there is no verse where God authorizes instrumental music, only singing. But in the old, it was authorized. And 2 Chronicles 29:25, which begins this passage, so declares. "Then he stationed the Levites in the house of the Lord with cymbals and stringed instruments and with harps, according to the commandments of David, of Gad the king's seer and of Nathan the prophet, for thus the commandment was of the Lord by his prophets. That is Old Testament authority for doing this. Again, there is no New Testament authority for using instruments of music, but there was in the Old Testament. But let's continue. The Levites stood with the instruments of David and the priests with the trumpets. Then Hezekiah commanded them to offer the burnt offering on the altar. And when the burnt offering began, the song of the Lord also began with the trumpets and with the instruments of David, king of Israel. So all the congregation worshiped. This is what's being described. All the congregations worshiped. The singers sang, the trumpeters sounded. All this continued until the burnt offering was finished. Well, there's an extra one on giving in case you didn't have enough earlier. And when they had finished offering, the king and all who were present with him bowed and worshiped. Moreover, King Hezekiah said to the leaders, commanded the Levites to sing praise to the Lord and the words of David and of Asaph the seer. So they sang the praises with gladness, and they bowed their heads and worshiped. Then Hezekiah answered and said, "Now that you have consecrated yourselves to the Lord, come near and bring," and there's the element of holiness again. "You've consecrated yourselves, come near and bring sacrifices and thank offerings into the house of the Lord." So the congregation brought in sacrifices and thank offerings, and as many were of a willing heart brought burnt offerings. So we see that singing is a part of worship, another thing associated with worship. Take a look at Revelation 15. Verses 3 and 4, which describes a scene around the throne in heaven. Revelation 15, verses 3 and 4. "And they sing the song of Moses, the servant of God, and the song of the Lamb, saying, Great and marvelous are your works, Lord God Almighty. Just and true are your ways, O King of the saints. Who shall not fear you, O Lord, and glorify your name? For you alone are holy, for all the nations shall come and worship before you, for your judgments have been manifested." And there again is the element of holiness and so on. But let's go to the next one, which is teaching. This was read for us earlier, that in Nehemiah chapter 8, verses 5 through 8, the people stood up and taught, and they gave the sense of the meaning of the law. A verse we did not read when we were reading Nehemiah 8, 5 through 8, was chapter 9 and verse 3. "And they stood up in their place and read from the book of the law of the Lord their God for one fourth of the day, and for another fourth they confessed and worshiped the Lord their God." So again, we find an association with teaching and worship. But here's even a better passage. In the New Testament, consider a well-known verse. John chapter 4 and verse 23. Question, how do you worship God in truth if teaching is not involved? How do you worship God in spirit and in truth if teaching is not involved? And so teaching has always been associated with true teaching, with worshiping God. Now we come to the Lord's Supper. The word worship is not mentioned, but what is the purpose of remembering Jesus? Is it not reverence? Is it not honor? Is it not kissing the hand toward? The word worship that is defined that way, proskuneo, in the New Testament. We are to discern the Lord's body and blood, we are to remember it, we are to think upon it. 1 Corinthians 11:29. Although worship is not used, the Lord's Supper is universally considered worship. And let's take a look at 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 16 and 17. And we have a couple other verses there too, if you want to turn over. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 16 and 17. The cup of blessing which we bless, and by the way, that means giving thanks for it, which involves prayer, is it not the communion of the blood of Christ? The bread which we break, is it not the communion of the body of Christ? For we, being many, are one bread and one body, for we all partake of that one bread. There is fellowship involved in taking the Lord's Supper, in remembering the Lord's death. And so to go on to the next part, what are we doing? We are giving thanks for the body. We are blessing it. We're giving thanks for the body and the blood of Jesus. And it's a matter of fellowship between Christians. Now, let's read verses 20 and 21, just a few verses later. But I say that the things which the Gentiles sacrifice, that's worship, they sacrifice to demons and not to God. And I do not want you to have fellowship with demons. You cannot drink the cup of the Lord and the cup of demons. You cannot partake of the Lord's table and the table of demons. Why? Why can't a Christian do both? Why can't he go in an idol's temple and fellowship what they're doing and then go with Christians and fellowship what they're doing? Why can't a Christian do both? Because it's a matter of worship. And it's a matter of fellowship. They are offering worship when they do what they do to pagan gods. We are offering worship in honor of the Lord Jesus Christ and fellowshipping one another as we do so. Now, I am not aware of any other expressions of worship that are on a par with these. But to answer the second part of the question, you can give anytime, but God required the congregation to give on the first day of the week, 1 Corinthians 16:2. You can sing anytime. You can pray anytime. You can study anytime and hopefully do, but we do it together on the first day of the week. The Lord's Supper is only for the first day of the week. You can't just do that anytime. You can remember and think in your mind about the sacrifice of Jesus at any time, but we get together to observe the table of the Lord on the first day of the week, just as we read in Acts chapter 20 and verse 7. Now, what about church projects? Church projects are a matter of service. Frequently in the Old Testament and the New, we read about worship and service. These two are related, but they're not the same. Service includes worship. When you're worshiping God, you're serving Him. But service is not worship. You can do many acts that serve God and serve other people, but that's not the same as worship. And so we have to distinguish between those two. So these expressions of worship we use because they have a biblical basis. We find people giving, and it's called worship, praying, and it's called worship. We find people singing, and it's called worship, studying the Bible, and it's referred to as worship. The Lord's Supper is not called that, but it obviously is a very intimate aspect of worship. So we are concerned then about scriptural worship, and that's why we use collectively these five expressions of worship. God is looking for those who worship in spirit and in truth. And so really the best question in all of this is to say, is that what I'm doing? Am I worshiping the God of heaven, the God who created us? Am I worshiping him in spirit and in truth? Well, in truth, these five expressions are included. And so we need to engage in those. And is it with the right spirit? Well, we could do these things without the right spirit. So we do need to have the proper attitude. We do need to be devoted in what we are doing and not just doing it because that's what we do, but because we really appreciate God and what he has done for us, and we want to honor him and worship him as we ought. This evening, if you have not been living as a Christian the way you ought, then it's time to make things right and worship God in spirit and in truth. If you have never obeyed the gospel but know what is involved, repentance, for baptism for the forgiveness of sins, we invite you to respond or to discuss it further at least so that you may know what the Bible teaches on the subject. Can we help you in any of these manners? Let us know while we stand and while we sing.